beautiful life.
สวัสดีครับ good afternoon and welcome to a beautiful life on englishonline.rmutp.ac.th my name is อาจารย์เกษมเกษมพุทธเรืองศรี your host for the program a beautiful life is a program broadcasted every monday from 1 p.m. to 1:30 p.m. articles and information about life lessons or good phrases from the books or websites will be presented in this programTogether with the latest news from Rajamongkol University of Technology, Pantnakhon. For Eugene and John, today we start with the article from China News Asia. They said global plastic treaty will only work if it caps production. Restricting how much plastic the world makes each year will be necessary to curb its harmful presence in the environment.Say a University of Leeds academic. Costas Velis reported from Leeds, England. An international agreement to end plastic pollution is due to be sealed this year in Busan, South Korea, at the penultimate round of negotiations held in Ottawa, Canada.Rwanda and Peru proposed a target to cut the weight of primary plastics produced worldwide by 40% by 2040 compared with 2025. This is the first time that a limit on the production of plastic has been considered at the UN talks aiming to develop an international legally binding instruction to end plastic pollution of thepotential mechanisms for tackling plastic pollution, a cap on plastic production was the most hotly debated, but one has not made it into the draft text of the treaty, not yet at Leeds. However, all efforts to scientifically model the extent of plastic pollution in the future assume that restricting how much plastic the world makes each year will be necessary, among other measures, to curb its harmful presence in the environment. In a 2020 study, the writer of this article, Costa Villis, co-author and his colleague, found that primary plastic production, the creation of new synthetic polymers, largely from fossil fuel, will need to be 47% lower in 2040 compared with the rate measured in 2016. This scenario would involve plastic production falling by as much as our research, from the research team considered practicable. It would predominantly mean everyone using significantly less plastic and substituting it with paper and materials that are compostable. Residual plastic pollution, cutting production almost in half and using all other strategies such as ramping up recycling and disposing of plastic waste in the landfills or via incineration plants would still leave residual pollution in 2040. In fact, just under 50 million tons of plastic would still be flowing into the ocean and rivers each year or accumulating on land where it may be burned in the open and create even more pollution. In a 2022 report, the OECD estimated that cutting demand for plastic by 33% relative to 2019 and enhancing recycling alongside preventing plastic escaping the waste management process would almost eliminate mismanaged plastic waste by 2060. That is, plastic that end up as pollution in the environment. A combination of measures such as there is considered the most effective scenario in cutting pollution, again, though the OECD model projects likely over 50 million tons of plastic waste being mismanaged annually in 2040. For the accumulation and burning of plastic in the environment to stop, we would have to wait another two decades. A simulation conducted in 2023 set an even more ambitious target for eliminating plastic pollution by 2040. In it, a cap on production alongside 15 other global policy measures which could cut annual mismanaged plastic waste by 90% and virgin plastic use by 30% yearly in 2040. Compared with 2019, this would represent a 60% reduction relative to 2040 levels without restrictions on production. In the 40%, the 40% reproduction target floated in Ottawa is generally consistent with what this model suggests is necessary to substantially reduce plastic pollution in coming decades. Whether such a production cap is plausible, however, is still poorly understood. With plastic production still increasing, it is unclear what policies would reduce it so steeply in just 15 years and what their side effects might be. What will it take? Reducing plastic production would require marked shifts in our lives for which there is little precedent. It could involve massive changes in how we behave as consumers, how products are designed and delivered to us, and so on. A 40% production cut would probably entail slashing the amount of packaging and single-use plastic made worldwide. These short-lived products account for around half of the plastic production and become waste quickly. Essentially, these would revert the trend in material use in the mid-20th century. Every year without production caps make the necessary cut to plastic production in future steeper and our need to use other measures to address the problem. Modeling the maids. The combination of policy and technical innovation necessary to eliminate plastic pollution is highly debated, but swinging production cuts feature in all modeled scenarios. A less dynamic piece of change is assumed to be necessary for downstream measures. Those associated with when plastic become waste, such as during disposal and recycling. Some of the emphasis on production caps is in model originates from the failure of existing waste management services to stop plastic from entering the environment or being burned outdoor. Since between 1.7 billion and 2.5 billion people still lack waste collection, some from of reproduction in the amount of new plastic made each year might seem attractive and consistent with the idea of a circular economy and the waste hierarchy which prioritizes waste prevention. Research, the writer of this article worked on recently showed that a country's waste management performance is strongly linked to its socioeconomic development. The collection, recycling, and disposal of plastic will only prevail as a solution to the extent that countries improve socioeconomically. Clearly, without radical change, the pace of progress on this front would not solve plastic pollution by 2040. What is iconic and illustrative of how daunting the challenge is is that deploying sound waste management to the under services is one of the field solutions that we understand relatively well based as it is on commercially and technically proven technologies and operational systems. By contrast, the three models offer three generic insights into what would be necessary to scale down. Plastic production. Replacing plastic with paper and card would not fundamentally improve matters if this packaging still ended up as waste being burned in the open. There are other options, though it could be possible to massively simplify the types of polymers used in packaging so that just a few are in circulation. This would make recycling more effective, as one of the present complications is the huge variation in materials that leads to cross-contamination. Likewise, country could massively expand system for reusing and refilling containers in shops. No matter the degree, pathway, and pace of plastic production cuts, a fundamental change in our relationship with plastic is necessary. As a target, 2040 seems impossibly close for a viable pathway to significantly lower production, but this should not stop us entertaining such a future. It should alert us to the scientific advance and innovation necessary to make it more possible. Let us think of it as a worthy investment of our resources and effect, one that we rely on for a better future. Costa Villis is lecturer in Resource Efficiency System, University of Leeds. This commentary first appeared on the conversation, so you can read more about this from China News Asia. Next, the article is, what resources do homeowners have with persistent water leaks? Developers can rely on the independent contraction defense to be held not liable for defects in residential private property, say lawyer Paul Sandosham and Lu Mingming. Paul Sandosham and Lu Mingming reported from Singapore. It has been said that a man's home is his castle. But what if there is a defect in the castle? Water leakages and seepages are not common problem in apartments. The issue is compounded in land scarce Singapore, where most people live in high-rise buildings with multiple floors and common property. It was reported earlier this year that a woman spent 100,000 Singapore dollar in a futile bid to stop water seeping through the ceiling and walls of her Sengkang flat. In Tenka, owner of new flat have complained about water leaking from their cooling units, which are connected to the centralized cooling system. What resource do homeowners have in relation to defects, particularly in relation to the vexed issue of water tightness? Establishing the root cause of the problem. Ultimately, resource depend on the root cause of the problem. It may be due to poor waterproofing by the contractor or poor design by the architect. Where multiple floors are involved, leak could emanate from the upper floor unit, adjacent unit, or common property. One good starting point would be to engage a building surveyor to investigate the the origins of any water leakage. Establishing the root cause of the problem is fundamental to the long-term resolution of the issue. If it is suspected that your neighbor's flat is involved, you might ask your neighbor to attend a joint inspection. Documenting the problem through clear photographs and videos with a date and timestamp is also crucial. In the event of, despite the strata titles board or the court will ultimately review and rely upon such evidence, seeking legal advice early is also advisable for clarity on your legal rights and obligations. Legal professionals can help you understand your options and provide guidance on the best course of action. The independent contractor defense. The problem is particularly acute for subsequent purchasers of property who do not have a contract with the developer. Developers can rely on the independent contractor defense, where they are not vicariously liable for the negligence of the main contractor responsible for construction works. Likewise, a main contractor is not liable for the negligence of his subcontractor when the independent contractor defense is made out. All that the developer or main contractor needs to establish is that they exercises reasonable care in appointing the subcontractors and subcontractor and subcontractant and subcontract and subconsultant, which is a relatively low bar. In 2011, the management corporation of the Seaview Condominium sued the main contractor and architects for defects in the property, including leaking windows, foul smells, and falling concrete blocks. The defendant main contractor and architect successfully relied on the independent contractor defense, as the main contractor and architect has had exercises reasonable care in appointing their independent subcontractors and subconsultants. They were not liable on negligence. The independent contractor defense therefore limits the resources available to homeowner by restricting them in claiming only against negligence subcontractors directly responsible for the property defects. Such parties may have limited financial resources to compensate homeowners for losses and damage caused by the defective work or design. Legislative reforms for property defects. Homes are one of the most significant economic commitments in a person's lifetime. Against the growing number of housing developments in land-dense Singapore, the Singapore Academy of Law Building and Construction Subcommittee recently penned a concept paper suggesting legislative reforms in relation to private residential property defects. It recommends the imposition of a warranty that makes developer and the main contractors liable to original and subsequent home buyers for property defects. These include structural cracks, fire safety defects, and deficient waterproofing. This would mean that the player with deeper pockets remain responsible for defects caused by the parties that they had engaged to carry out the works. Another recommendation is to extend the limitation period, the period of time within which a homeowner must bring a claim against the contractor. The usual limitation period is usually 6 years from the date the project was completed. The subcommittee proposes extending the limitation period to 15 years for cases of major defects, while retaining the 6-year limitation period for defects related to quality and workmanship. Finally, a broad proposal is to introduce compulsory insurance that can cover the full duration and extent of reliability of defects after the completion of works, including works done by subcontractors. It remains to have seen whether the broad proposals for reform will be taken on board, but if in place, they will empower homeowners in seeking resource for dreadful and costly defects like water leaks. Paul Sandocham is partner at Clifford, Sean Asia, and Lu Mingming is partner at Eldan Law LLP. So you can read more about this from China News Asia, and we'll be right back after a short break.
Beautiful Life.
You are listening to A Beautiful Life on EnglishOnline.rmutp.ac.th. We are back to the news. Ratchamongkhon University of Technology Phanakorn attended the steering committee meeting developing the Dusit District. On May 1st, 2024, Assistant Professor Sattha Kang Pen Khae was assigned by the President of Ratchamongkhon University of Technology Phanakorn to be a representative to attend the meeting of the Participant Steering Committee for the Development of Dusit District. There are government agencies, private sector, the public sector, and academics participate in selecting a position in the steering committee and a special working group for in all dimensions, including economics, society and quality of life, environmental aspect and increasing green space, education and technology, utilities, infrastructures and traffic and cleanliness, orderliness and safety. This was gathering of people driving the development of Dusit District. It is considered another channel of communication between citizens and citizens or the people in and Bangkok. In participating in brainstorming, reflecting on problems, including suggesting ways to solve problems for the joint development of Dusit District, including using such information as a tool for developing Bangkok to continue to be sustainable city to live in together, with the director of the Dusit District Office along with the district administrators and related officials attended to consider and give advice at the Samarjai Meeting Room, 4th floor, Ratchawat Building, Dusit District Office, Bangkok. Meanwhile, Ratchamongkhon University of Technology Phanakorn held a ceremony to present certificates to graduate vocational certificate level of PowerShaw academic year 2024-2023 for the fourth time. Ratchamongkhon University of Technology Phanakorn organized a certificate award ceremony vocational certificate level of PowerShaw academic year 2023 with Associate Professor Dr. Natachot Rakthai Charan, Chief Vice President for Academic Affairs and Faculty Development, presides over the certificate award ceremony and give certificates of honor to graduates with the most outstanding academic results, including presenting the Ratchamongkhon Medal of Phanakorn Award certificates to students with outstanding academic results, provide scholarship to pursue a bachelor's degree, ready to give advice to graduates to express appreciation and ask moral support for graduates and parents at the Phuong Nea Conference Room, Student Affairs Building, Faculty of Engineering, North Bangkok Center on May 1st, 2024. in academic year 2023, there are graduates of a total of 152 subjects divided into 24 subjects in commerce subject and in commerce subject and 128 subjects in industrial subjects. At this certificate awarding ceremony, there is graduates with the most outstanding academic results. Two students receive a Rajamongkol University of Technology Phanakorn Medal and receive student certificates with outstanding academic results. Commerce subject category 3 cases, industrial subject category 16 cases, home economic subject category 1 case. In addition, the university scholarship are available to support scholarship towards an undergrad student. Good study, good behavior category 2 cases and good behavior category, but there is a lack of funds for 3 cases. And the last one, Rajamongkol University of Technology Phanakorn strengthen moral knowledge, ethics and code of conduct. Dr. Natwarapol Ratsiri Wacharabun, President of Rajamongkol University of Technology Phanakorn, shared the opening of the knowledge project about morality, ethics and code of conduct at a Marine Room, 3rd floor, SD Avenue Hotel, Bangkok, on April 25th, 2023, attended by 150 university personnel, with the objective of increasing knowledge of morality, correct ethics and moral in the work of personnel, create efficiency and effectiveness in their work, to prevent disciplinary offense, civil law, and strengthen morality, ethics, and code of conduct for personnel, including creating knowledge and understanding about the application of moral principle, ethics, and code of ethics are used in work performance, being good moral discipline, and be a good and correct role model for society. This event was honored by Kun Niwat Chai Kasem Mongkon, Secretary General of Committee, Office of the National Anti-Corruption, NACC, gave a lecture on strengthen the attitude of being responsible for duty, honesty, and integrity in work. Assistant Professor Dr. Kaside Suthiwanit, Vice President for University Council Affairs, give a lecture on moral enhancement ethics for government officials, and Kun Orathai Homkao, legal expert, give a lecture on knowledge about the regulations of Rajamongkol University of Technology Phanakorn concerning the code of ethics. And the time is up for today. Beautiful life. Please join us on every Monday here on englishonline.rmutp.ac.th. Your host has been Ajahn Kasem, Kasem Puttaryongsi. You're welcome to subscribe to our channel on englishonline.rmutp.ac.th. Thank you very much for joining our program today, and see you again next Monday. สวัสดีครับ.
Beautiful Life will be back again next Monday.